ओम ज्ञानतिमिरन्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकय चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टम् स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपः कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वापदान्तिकम् जय श्रीकृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभो नित्यानन्द श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवास आदि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे हरे
कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे हरे
हरे राम हरे राम
हरे राम हरे राम
राम राम हरे हरे
राम राम हरे हरे
हरे कृष्णा
हरे कृष्णा
थैंक यू ऑल फॉर जॉइनिंग फॉर दिस थर्ड सेशन आउट ऑफ द सिक्स पार्ट सेमिनार ऑन द लाइफ ऑफ द सिक्स गोस्वामीज ऑफ वृंदावन इन द लास्ट टू डेज ऑफ आवर डिस्कशन वी हैव डिस्कस्ड द लाइफ ऑफ श्रील रघुनाथ भट्ट गोस्वामी ऑन डे वन एंड द लाइफ ऑफ श्रील रघुनाथ दास गोस्वामी ऑन डे टू So four more acharyas to go, and this session we are going to dedicate our time, energy, and listening, speaking abilities at the lotus feet of such a glorious, wonderful Gaudiya Vaishnava saint, whose works are very significant and profusely quoted. I know the minds are still trying to think and guess. I'll let that happen for some time. But the hint is, although this great, wonderful Vaishnava has contributed so much and has lived such a wonderful life in Vrindavan, he's hardly mentioned anywhere. And as you all rightly guessed, it is Srila Gopal Bhatta Goswami. Our dear Soumya had requested and guessed very wonderfully last night that I think it's going to be Gopal Bhatta Goswami. I said, why do you think so? She said, on day one, I thought you're going to start from like Rupa Goswami, Sanatan Goswami, and then on. But then it seems like you're going from Raghunath Bhatta Goswami upward. So my guess is it's going to be Gopal Bhatta Goswami tomorrow. And I looked at her and I said, but you also know I can break the pattern, right? She said, yes. But to my fullest satisfaction and fulfillment, I want to dedicate this session in the descriptive narration of the life of Srila Gopal Bhatta Goswami. Srila Gopal Bhatta Goswami is not even mentioned in Chaitanya Bhagavat. He's not described in Chaitanya Mangal of Srila Lochandas Thakur, Sri Chaitanya Bhagavat of Srila Vrindavandas Thakur. Even Srila Kavi Karnapur doesn't describe Gopal Bhatta Goswami. They've all seemed to very mysteriously sideline this great personality and try to eclipse his existence. Even in Chaitanya Charitamrita, Srila Krishnadas Kaviraj Goswami doesn't profusely describe and mention. He says Srila Gopal Bhatta Goswami as one of his six prominent Siksha Gurus. Mukund Murari Gupta in his Karchas has described Gopal Bhatta Goswami. Narottam Das Thakur in Prem Vilas, his book, has described Gopal Bhatta Goswami. But the profuse description that we find, all glories to Srila Narahari Chakravarti's Bhakti Ratnakar, describes Gopal Bhatta Goswami's life. But still, it's not profusely, significantly described as Srila Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami, which for the coming days to follow, we will listen their narration. Srila Gopal Bhatta Goswami. So isn't it wonderful that just like the deities were hiding behind the curtain, the glories of Gopal Bhatta Goswami was hiding behind the curtain of the Goswami literatures. But as soon as we started speaking about Bhakti Ratnakar, how it has opened up the curtain, the lords opened their curtains to listen to the glories of Gopal Bhatta Goswami. Srila Gopal Bhatta Goswami's glories are very dear to the ears of Shishi Gaur Nithai. So they want to hear very attentively. Srila Gopal Bhatta Goswami is described. Is there something?
You want water?
No, I'm good. Yeah. Srila Gopal Bhatta Goswami is described as an incarnation of Ananga Manjari and also described in other places as an incarnation or an expansion of Guna Manjari. Now what is interesting is Ananga Manjari is Radharani's younger sister. So Gopal Bhatta Goswami is actually a manifestation of Radharani's younger sister in Gaur Lila. Gopal Bhatta Goswami's life starts off with his appearance in a village called Belagudi, which is on the banks of the holy river Kaveri, very near to the most exalted Sri Rangam, the capital headquarters of Sripad Ramanujacharya. In Sri Rangam once, Sripad Ramanujacharya was honoring prasadam with his dear associates. And he chewed on the fruit, the pulp of the fruit, and threw the peel. And as he threw the peel, one fish from a nearby pond came ahead and touched the remnants of Sripad Ramanujacharya. And as soon as the fish touched the peel, which has been sucked upon by Sripad Ramanujacharya, in front of everyone's eyes, the fish assumed a four-handed Vishnudutta form and went back to Vaikuntha. So the disciples of Sripad Ramanujacharya were very confused and bewildered. They asked Sripad Ramanujacharya, "We honor your prasadam every day. And we haven't seen any four-handed form that's manifesting and going back to Vaikuntha, but this fish just accidentally happened to touch the remnants and is going back home back to Godhead. Why?" Sripad Ramanujacharya said, "Familiarity breeds contempt. You are certainly partaking in my remnants, but not with as much reverence as much as the fish in the pond." Ati parichayad avajna. When anything rare becomes easily available, we lose the value for how rare it is, because now it's easily accessible. Just like the scriptures that we have, the Bhagavad Gita, Bhagavatam, Chaitanya Charitamrita that we have. Bhaktivinoda Thakur took 8 years to find a copy of Chaitanya Charitamrita in Bengal. So he's trying to search for a Bengali text in Bengal, and it took him 8 years. And now we can just go walk into our ISKCON center and get a Chaitanya Charitamrita set. So therefore, because it's easily available, oftentimes we lose the value for how rare and how valuable it is. We will speak about this later in the discussion when I speak about the disciples of Sripad Gopal Bhatta Goswami. So in the headquarters of Sripad Ramanujacharya and his guru, Sripad Yamunacharya, that is Sri Rangam, the beautiful temple of Sri Ranganatha Swami. There were three brothers described: Tirumala Bhat, Venkata Bhat, and Prabuddha Bhat. Prabuddha Bhat later on went on to become the great Prabodhananda Saraswati Bhat. Very great exalted Vaishnava. Venkata Bhat, the second brother out of the three, gave birth to Gopal Bhatta Goswami, who's called Gopal Bhatta as a child. Gopal Bhatta Goswami grew up and happened to learn Shastra under his uncle, Prabodhananda Saraswati. Srila Prabodhananda Saraswati, who's so exalted, is not described in many scriptures. But interestingly, our Kavi Karanapur, in his Gaur Ganodesh Deepika, describes Prabodhananda Saraswati to be an incarnation of Tunga Vidya Sakhi, yeah, one of the Ashta Sakhis. Yeah. And not just that, he mentions Sarva Shastra Visharada. This Prabodhananda Saraswati is not just incarnation of Tunga Vidya Sakhi, but is actually an erudite scholar in every possible stream of Vedic study. Also, Gopal Bhatta Goswami, in the introductory verse to Hari Bhakti Vilas, he mentions his Gurudev, Prabodhananda Saraswati, as Bhagavat Priya, or he who is very dear to Bhagavat, Bhagavat. And Nabhaji in his Bhaktamal also describes Prabodhananda Saraswati to be Chaitanya Priya Parashada. So Prabodhananda Saraswati's glories, like Gopal Bhatta Goswami, has been kept confidential only to be revealed later in time. So now, for those who just joined us, we're describing Prabodhananda Saraswati's dear disciple, Gopal Bhatta Goswami, this session. Is everyone there in the discussion? I took academic philosophical route only to get you back to the story, don't worry. Because we always hear the stories, but it's always good to have this perspective of what the academic scholars see our tradition as, especially in comparative religious study, how they see and what the research has and what are the back and forth debates. So it's good to know. Now, if you thought that's all that's going to be in the class, don't worry, that was just the introduction. Now let's get into the story. So we were describing the life of three wonderful brothers who were priests at Sri Rangam, serving the lotus feet of Sri Ranganatha Swami: Tirumala Bhat, Venkata Bhat, and Prabodhananda Saraswati. Venkata Bhat gave birth to Gopal Bhatta. Some academic scholars claim 1503 to be his exact date of birth. Some say it is 1500, some say 1501. So to be safe, Gopal Bhatta Goswami appeared between 1500 and 1503, around the same time as Raghunath Bhatta Goswami, and so on and so forth. Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu took sannyas in 1510 at the age of 24. And in the next 2 years, from 1510 to 1512, he made his first visit to South India. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, while coming to South India, Chaitanya Charitamrita Kaviraj Goswami very mercifully, very compassionately describes the different places that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu stopped at. And they are very beautifully described. He describes Vishakhapatnam. He describes Simhachalam. He describes Godavari, and on the banks of Godavari, meeting Ramananda Rai at Rajamundri. He describes Ahobila Kshetra. He describes Chaitanya Mahaprabhu visiting Tirupati, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu visiting Kanchipuram, and then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu visiting Sri Rangam, the banks of Kaveri River. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came and he went to the temple of Sri Ranganatha Swami. He took his bath in Kaveri and went to the temple of Ranganatha Swami, and there was another tumultuous kirtan there. So many thousands and thousands of devotees following Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, completely attracted by his beautiful form. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was singing and roaring like a lion. Oftentimes Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is referred to as Hari. And the word Hari apart from so many other meanings that we know, also means a lion. So therefore, when we call Sri Narasimha Dev, we also call him as Narahari, half man and half lion. And why is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu called a lion? Chaitanya Chandramrita Prabodhananda Saraswati answers this. He says Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had five qualities like a lion. He had a golden complexion like a lion. He had his hair cascaded up to his shoulder like a lion. He had broad chest and thin waist like a lion. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu appeared in the Simha Rashi, the lion constellation. And five, like a lion would enter a cave and roar thunderously, and the elephants hiding in that dark cave would tremble and run out to save their life, and then the lion would sit inside the cave and conquer the cave as his personal den. Similarly, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would come and roar in the caves of the hearts of the devotees. And the elephant-like lust and anger and greed and envy sitting inside would flee away, and Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would claim proprietorship over this cave and claim the heart of the devotees as his personal den. But what would he roar in the heart? Is a good question. What would he roar in the heart? Hari Bol! Hari Bol! Hari Bol! This is what he would roar. When we say Hari Bol, it's almost like the meowing of a cat. But he would roar. Can we try? 3, 2, 1, let's go.
Hari Bol! Hari Bol! Hari Bol!
So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is called a lion. So he would roar and do tumultuous kirtan with kartals and mridangas and chanting and dancing and singing. And looking at Ranganatha Swami, seeing his complexion, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would remember Shyam Sundara Vrindavan. And he would roll on the ground crying and weeping, remembering Krishna, Krishna. So this priest, Venkatabhat, when he saw this sannyasi dancing and chanting like this, his hair was standing on end because he was a pure Vaishnava. They were Brahmanas from South India. Very pure in the Sri Vaishnava line. Very pure. Very high class. Worshippers of Lakshmi and Narayan. Pure hearted. So when he saw Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he looked at his bodily beauty and looked at the symptoms. He could understand this is not just another sannyasi visiting. This is the Lord of his life coming as a devotee. So he held the lotus feet of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and requested him, "My house is very close to this temple. Would you kindly visit?" So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu agreed. And Venkatabhat, along with all the devotees, took Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to his house. And just like Raghunath Bhatta Goswami's father, Tapana Mishra, had washed the lotus feet of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and asked Raghunath Bhatta to distribute the Charanamrit, drink the Charanamrit, sprinkle on his head and sprinkle on the heads of the Vaishnavas. Similarly, Venkatabhat, he washed the lotus feet of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, gave the first Charanamrit to young Gopal Bhatta. And young Gopal Bhatta at that time, it's described, was between 7 to 10 years old, depending on when he appeared. And at that age, interestingly, Raghunath Bhatta Goswami, Raghunath Das Goswami and Gopal Bhatta Goswami, all three are getting high class Krishna conscious association right from childhood. It's so wonderful. And they all follow the same pattern of associating with high class devotees, chanting with them, accepting the Charanamrita of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Gopal Bhatta Goswami, it's described when in the Bhakti Ratnakar, when he drank the Charanamrita of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he was weeping and crying. Why? Because Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is Radharani. And Gopal Bhatta Goswami, being Ananga Manjari, is Radharani's younger sister. So they are reuniting again. Two sisters are uniting. Venkatabhat knew his son Gopal Bhatta was a very exalted soul. Because once when they took him to Jagannath Puri, Gopal Bhatta Goswami looked at the chakra of Jagannath on the top of the temple and he rolled on the ground calling out, "Jagannath, Jagannath, Jai Jagannath." And this was when he was about 4 years old. So they are certainly very divine. They are sent down by Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So Gopal Bhatta Goswami accepted the Charanamrita. And under the guidance of his father, they offered prasadam to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu accepted prasadam and the remnants were distributed. Then, just like Raghunath Bhatta Goswami massaged the lotus feet of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, here we have Gopal Bhatta Goswami massaging the lotus feet of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And he massaged up to the thighs of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, it's described. Mahaprabhu was resting. After having little prasad, he's taking little rest. Now Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told Venkatabhat, it's time for me to go. So Venkatabhat said, now it's Chaturmas time. And during Chaturmasya, the sannyasis don't travel. They try to live in one place because it's going to be, you know, watery everywhere, muddy pools. It's not concrete. You cut through the villages and jungles. So it's not very anukul for bhajan. It's not very favorable. So sannyasis try to get one holy dham and they reside there for 4 months chanting the holy name. So he said, see, Srirangam is a holy dham and the river Kaveri is here, Ranganatha Swami is here, the devotees are here, chanting and dancing is here, and this is Chaturmasya. Why not we sit here? Why not you give us your association and you speak Hari Katha, Krishna Katha, and Krishna Kirtan and Krishna Prasadam with Hari Bhakta? Chaitanya Mahaprabhu thought and found this to be very tempting. So he agreed. He said, yes, 4 months I will stay with you. These 4 months, Gopal Bhatta Goswami was employed, not employed, but he was given the chance of personally serving Chaitanya Mahaprabhu 24 hours a day for 4 months as a child. So the common pattern that we find, so if you want your child to be a Goswami, all the stories give the same parenting pranali. The path of parenting. 4 months give them to some exalted soul. And then when they come back and you tell them to study, they will be crying and weeping, Krishna, Krishna. Ami ghare na jai bhavan praveshi bhavan. I won't come home, I won't enter the forest and find Radha and Krishna. So 4 months Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would bathe in the Kaveri River, go to take darshan of Sri Ranganatha Swami. There used to be tamalshas, kirtan and katha. And Gopal Bhatta Goswami would drink charanamrita every day. He would feed prasadam every day. He was almost like a menial personal servant. For everything that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu did, Gopal Bhatta Goswami was there witnessing the pastimes of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. How his mind and consciousness were completely captivated, day in and day out. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu at that time was with his personal servant called Govindadas. Some biographies also describe a personal servant by the name Krishnadas was also accompanying Chaitanya Mahaprabhu at that time. So Gopal Bhatta Goswami was speaking to Govindadas every day about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Govindadas would describe how Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was a very naughty boy in Nadia. Because Gopal Bhatta Goswami was a young boy, so to make Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's pastimes relatable, he would talk about when Mahaprabhu was your age, this is what he would do. Mm-hmm. You know, he made the Brahmana cook 3 times. Mm-hmm. And he would throw all the ink on his body and fake as if he's gone to school. Mm-hmm. And when the Brahmanas would, the Rishis would take bath in the Ganga and come out, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would spit on their face. I have to give a warning, please don't try this at home. And also, they would go underwater. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, Nimai would go underwater and pull the dhoti and the legs of the sadhus and they would be under and they would have no dhoti. They can't come out. And sometimes he would pull their beard and sometimes as they're meditating, he would sit on their back and pick their back. He was very naughty. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was a very naughty boy. He would sit on a pile of dirt and would start eating them. Sometimes he would embrace a snake, remembering Anantadev. And sometimes when the thieves would kidnap him, he would sit on their shoulder and bewilder them and get them back to his house. Of course, Yoga Maya and Mahamaya energies are at his feet. So he's the lord of bewilderment. He doesn't get bewildered, but he bewilders. Positively and negatively. Negatively as Mahamaya and positively as Yogamaya. So all these pastimes when Gopal Bhatta Goswami as a child would hear, he would think, how I wish I was born in Nadia during the time of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and I could be Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's friend and I could see all these pastimes. Oh, I wish I was born there. And he would think about Brahma and he would say, what did you think when you thought of designing my birth here? You chopped out my birth and my timing of my birth. Place and time, both wrong. The time and place should have been, the place should have been Nadia and the time should have been during Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's time. I'm 15 years late. This is not correct. So Gopal Bhatta Goswami would cry every day, but he wouldn't tell Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Amidst his service, tears would come. And Mahaprabhu would ask him what happened and he would not speak up. Because that would break Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's heart. That Gopal Bhatta Goswami, seeing the sannyas form, is feeling so hurt in his heart that he wants to see Nimai of Nadia with locks of soft black hair and all the naughty pastimes. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, as being super soul, he understood. Gopal Bhatta Goswami went off to sleep, and in his dream, Gopal Bhatta Goswami saw a very beautiful mystical dream. He was transported to Nadia. And in Nadia, he was seeing all these pastimes of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He saw Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's naughty pranks. He saw Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's form. He saw Chaitanya Mahaprabhu with locks of soft black hair. Then he saw Chaitanya Mahaprabhu as a householder, dancing and chanting with Nityananda Prabhu and Advaita Acharya. And Gopal Bhatta Goswami was in ecstasy, trembling in his dream. And at that time, Nityananda Prabhu and Advaita Acharya called Gopal Bhatta Goswami and embraced him to their chest, to their heart. And Nitya and Advaita both caught hold of the ear of Gopal Bhatta Goswami and came very close to speak a secret. And Gopal Bhatta Goswami was very attentive to hear, and as he was being enthusiastic to hear the message, his dream broke. Have you sometimes had dreams going off to sleep again to see if the dream continues?
Yes.
I would feel like that as a child. Sometimes I would have a dream and I would think, oh, why did I get up? I wish I could go off to sleep and continue from there. But unfortunately, it's not so. So Gopal Bhatta Goswami woke up and he realized, he was heartbroken to know that this was just a dream. He went running to Chaitanya Mahaprabhu to tell him what he actually saw. But when he went there, he didn't see Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He saw Krishna playing on the flute. पहिला देखिला तुमार सन्यासी स्वरूप एवे तुमा देखे मोई श्याम गोपरूप. The sannyasi swarup had become Shyama Goparup. The golden form of renunciation had now transformed as the lord of enjoyment in Vrindavan playing on his flute. Krishna would press his left cheek to his left hand and press the flute to his lips, and standing in a threefold bending form, play the flute. And as he's playing the different notes, he would relish and he would move his eyebrows in personal relishment of his own ragas. It is described in the Bhagavatam. Vama bahu krita vama kapalo valgita bror adhar arpita venu komalanguli bhir ashrita margam gopyairayati yatra mukunda. This is the first verse of Yugal Gita, Canto 10, Chapter 35. So, and as Krishna's playing the flute, the demigods have all assembled. And all the Matajis, the demigod Matajis, they're all trying to jump off to get to Krishna. And Mother Earth underneath is trembling in ecstasy. And the deer and the cow and the peacocks are all like painted pictures looking at Krishna. And amidst this, Krishna's playing and looking at his friends and look to the left, look to the right, look above, look below. And stylishly Krishna's playing the flute. So this is what Gopal Bhatta Goswami saw. He said, Krishna! Then when he looked closely, he was Nimai of Nadia. The form that he wanted to see. All those pastimes he was seeing. And he bowed down to touch the lotus feet. He said, yes, my lord, this is what I wanted to see. And when he got up, he was the form of a sannyasi. With shaven head and shikha, dress of renounced order of life. Gopal Bhatta Goswami looked at Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and revealed his dream, and Mahaprabhu said, yes, this is why I showed you this form. But till now, I haven't revealed to anyone my identity. So you got to keep quiet. You have to keep this confidential that I am the Supreme Lord. I have come here to taste Radha Bhav. Just keep this in your heart. He embraced Gopal Bhatta Goswami, bathed him profusely with his tears, empowered him, blessed him, and said, I will work miraculously through you in the future. You will go to Vrindavan and perform activities and services which I would like to do, but I can't because I will be in Jagannath Puri. You will assist Rupa and Sanatan Goswami in writing Vedic literature. And you will also give Diksha and have many disciples. You will teach Srimad Bhagavatam and the Vedic literature, and I'll empower you for all this. Gopal Bhatta Goswami was very ecstatic. Continued serving Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Then it is described, the 4 months of Chaturmas ended. As Chaitanya Mahaprabhu decided to leave, Gopal Bhatta Goswami was crying. He said, please take me with you. Just like Raghunath Bhatta Goswami was asking. Just like Raghunath Das Goswami was asking. How many times did Raghunath Das Goswami ask Mahaprabhu last night? Twice. And Mahaprabhu said, no, go home. Serve your parents. So the instruction that Raghunath Bhatta Goswami and Raghunath Das Goswami received is the same instruction that now Chaitanya Mahaprabhu is giving Gopal Bhatta Goswami. During these 4 months of Chaturmas, I had so many beautiful, wonderful conversations. Every spot in the house had pastimes of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Have you ever felt when guests come and visit you and they stay for a week or two and then once they leave, your house seems vacant? Have you had that? Then you look at the table, you look at the sitting place, you look at the altar and you feel, you imagine that guest, you know, used to be sitting here, used to speak from here, the person used to sing here, the person used to worship a Shaligram here. He would wake up at this time, he would chant at this time. All day long, it's just this going on. And it takes a few days to overcome, yes? And that's just with devotees that we interact with. Can you imagine Radha and Krishna coming as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and living in your house for 4 months? Gopal Bhatta Goswami was crying. He was holding the hand and the lotus feet of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and said, please stay here, please stay here. If not, 4 months, at least 2 more months. Mahaprabhu said, I cannot. Sannyasi cannot take residence like this. No, at least 1 more month for me. Mahaprabhu said, I cannot. At least up to next Ekadashi. Mahaprabhu agreed. So he extended the stay by 2 weeks. During these 4 months of stay, Mahaprabhu had wonderful conversations with Venkata Bhat, which are described in the biographies. Now, Sri Venkata Bhat, coming from a Sri Sampradaya line, respected and worshipped and adored Lakshmi Narayan, Lakshmi Narasimha, Lakshmi Varaha, Sri Ramachandra, Lakshmi Hayagriva. Like you see all the Ahovelamat, you have very beautiful deities. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu would have discussions because his Bab is from Vrindavan, Radharani's Bab, so he would speak to Venkata Bhat. He would say, I want to ask you a few questions. Because you're so scholarly. He was very learned in Sanskrit and in so many streams of Vedanta. So he said, I have a question. Please tell me, why did your Lakshmi leave your Narayan? Venkata Bhat was shocked. He said, when? Why did your Lakshmi leave your Narayan to come to Vrindavan? Please tell me. So Venkata Bhat said, my lord, there is nothing wrong here. Because Narayan and Sri Krishna are the same personality. So Lakshmi is very chaste. So she is just accepting one form of her eternal husband over another form. So she's still chaste. There's nothing wrong in this. Because they were the... Venkata Bhat in the Sri Sampradaya line were convinced that Narayana is actually the origin even for Krishna. They would say Ramchandra appeared in Ayodhya, Krishna appeared in Mathura, Narasimha appeared from a pillar, Varaha appeared from the nostril of Brahma, but Sriman Narayana never appears. He's eternally there. So all of them are appearing, but he is eternally there, so it's his incarnations who come down. But we know, as Jayadev Goswami describes, Keshava Dhrita, Meena Sharira, Keshava Dhrita, Sukara Rupa. So Keshava, who's Keshava? He who killed Keshi, that is Krishna. And Krishna took these different forms. So in the Dashavatar Stotra, when we see, we don't see Keshava Dhrita, Krishna Sharira. because it is Krishna who is manifesting all these different forms. He is the root. Ete chamsa kalapumsam krishnastu bhagavan swayam indrari vyakulam lokam vridayanti lukim. So Sriman Narayana and Sri Krishna are one in tattva, one in philosophy. But as far as rasa is concerned, as far as intimacy is concerned, Sri Krishna is the Lord of sweetness, while Sriman Narayana is the Lord of greatness. It's the same personality. But when they display the mood of opulence, that is Sriman Narayana. It's like the father at work, very professional and corporate. But the same father at home, he is in his shorts, sleeping on a couch, reading newspaper. And no one can say anything. It's the same personality that you see conducting all these meetings. But that is the great aspect of him, this is the sweet aspect of him. Here the intimacy is higher. So when these questions were asked to Venkatabhat, he said, my Lord, it's the same personality, there is no difference. So Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu asked another question. Yes, I agree. I'm not saying she's not chaste. She's very much chaste. But please do tell me, she came to Vrindavan, why didn't she get an entry into the Rasalila? Why is she still performing tapasya at Belwan? So for those who have been to Belwan for Parikrama, you will see Sri Lakshmi Devi's temple in Vrindavan, Brajmandal. So why didn't she enter the Rasalila of the Brajagopis? So Venkatabhat was now stumped. He can't say anything. He looked at Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and he said, you are that Narayana, you are that Krishna, please reveal the truth to me. And Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu explained that Vrindavan is the land of sweetness. Vaikuntha is the land of opulence. It is Aishwarya Bhumi, while Vrindavan is Madhurya Bhumi. In Vrindavan, it is not that the Aishwarya, the opulence doesn't exist. But the sweetness, the Madhurya is super excellent and it's so high class that it eclipses all opulences of the Lord. In the Brihad Bhagavatamrita, in the systematic elevation and gradual progressive path of Gop Kumar in the story, describes this fact too. In Vaikuntha, everyone worships and approaches Sriman Narayana in the mood that I am your servant and you are my eternal Lord. But in Vrindavan, no one considers Krishna to be their Lord. This is one reason why Krishna had to leave Vrindavan, because he thought if I speak Bhagavad Gita in Vrindavan, no one will take me seriously. They will say, you are speaking Bhagavad Gita? You? What do you know to speak? They have so much love in Vrindavan. It's not that we depend on Krishna. They have this sweet feeling that Krishna depends on us. Even the friends of Krishna, they punch Krishna, they kick Krishna, they slap Krishna, they pinch Krishna. Not with the consideration that he is God. Of course, Krishna still remains God. But they don't care whether or not he is God. Their love for Krishna is independent of Krishna's identity as Bhagavan. It is very intimate and very high class. And this is what attracts Krishna. In the Chaitanya Charitamrita, it is described, Sakala jagate more kare vidhi bhakti. Vidhi bhakti brajabhav paite nahi shakti. Aishwarya shitila prem nahi mora preet. It is described by Kaviraj Goswami, Krishna speaking his heart, that I don't like this mood where people are bowing down to me all the time. Of course, in a conditioned state, when we haven't established our relationship with Krishna, we must bow down because we are very offensive. But once we have established our eternal relationship with Krishna in divine ecstatic love, then we act on that relationship. But now we cannot immaturely jump onto that relationship because we haven't developed it completely. So we must walk through the door of Vaidhi Bhakti, which naturally, spontaneously opens as Ragmarg. So in Vrindavan, the friends, they play with Krishna. Sometimes they are wrestling with Krishna. And they are punching and putting Krishna down. He who's Mrityor Mrityum Namamyaham. He's fighting for his life with the friends in Vrindavan. And the rule was, anyone who drops his friend down to the ground wins the wrestling match. So Krishna was fighting Sri Dama, Radharani's brother. So they're like fighting. And Radharani's brother Sri Dama is fighting, and Krishna's fighting, and they're fighting. And finally Sri Dama topples Krishna down. And 3, 2, 1, and he wins.
And everyone is saying, Jai, 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 Jai. And Krishna gets up and he also says, Jai, Jai, Jai. Krishna's camper like, no, you shouldn't say Jai. You've lost the game. You don't know when to say Jai. They are saying Jai for the opposite team. You're not supposed to say Jai. So Krishna says, no, I'm saying Jai because I won it. I won this wrestling match. Now everyone looks towards Krishna and said, everyone witnessed that you were on the ground and Sridharma was on your chest and everyone did the countdown and you lost it, Krishna. Krishna said, no, I won it. I can prove it to you. Okay, go ahead. Krishna said, when I was punched down, look at Sridharma's nose. It was pointing down. But my nose was pointing up. And the competition was, he whose nose points the sun wins the game. Now what would they say? They looked at Krishna and said, don't invent rules, please. This was not the rule. Just accept that you lost. And now you have to carry the enemy camp, the opposing winning camp on the back. Krishna said, I'm not going to do it. Why are you not going to do it? Krishna said, because I'm the future king of Vrindavan. That's why I'm not going to do it. I can dictate terms. He said, don't get your aristocratic birth right here. Raja hoge ghar pe. You may be the king or the prince, the future king at your house, not here. If you want to play, you play properly. Don't get in these rules. Become a horse. Krishna said, I'm not going to become a horse. Why are you not going to become a horse? Because my father has 900,000 cows. That's why. So if you tell me to become a cow, I would. But horse is too rajasic. Friends got together and had a meeting. They said, we're not going to take Krishna. Krishna, you either become a horse or don't play with us. Krishna said, okay, I'm not going to play with you. You think without you, I have, you know, I'm just going to be all by myself? I have other friends. I'll go and play with them. Go, you go your way, I go my way. Now, everyone knows for sure Krishna has no one except them. But the confidence is sky high.
Thakur ji hai jo chahe kar sake.
What can we say? So they said, okay, you go play with your friends. And Krishna sat under a tree with a face like a balloon, a red balloon. And then all other friends are playing and they're looking at Krishna and they're smiling, you know, because they want to rub more salt to the wound. So Krishna's sitting all by themselves and they're smiling at Krishna and they're playing, all the friends. And Krishna looks to the side and he looks to the other side and he looks and then he takes his head again. And finally, after some time, Krishna bursts in tears, crying. So some friends, their heart melts. The other friends come and say, drama karta hai. He's a drama master. You know, he's a dramatic fellow. He's just trying to do all this emotional melodrama. Don't look at him. He's just trying to seek attention. Don't look at him. So after some point, some friends come to Krishna and say, why are you crying? Krishna said, I left Vaikuntha to come and play with you and you're leaving me? Where will I go? Whom will I play with? So they looked at Krishna and said, do you want to play with us? Krishna said, yes. Will you become a horse? Krishna said, let me think. The friend said, better say a yes because the next game, if you lose, you have to become a donkey. So it's better to be at Rajas than to go Tamas. Krishna agreed. He became a horse and the friend started sitting on the back. So in Vaikuntha, this is not possible. But in Vrindavan, this is possible. The same Lord. Similarly, Mother Yashoda, how high is her love? Mm. How high? Did you eat dirt, Krishna? His mouth is filled with dirt. The Lord of Hanuman. And Mother Yashoda is saying, why did you eat dirt? And through his eyes he's saying, I didn't eat dirt. And he can't open his mouth because he'll be proven wrong. I didn't eat dirt. No, you did eat dirt. Who told you? Somebody told me. Oh, they're your sakis, they will after all take your side. No, your friends told me. But I always share everything with my friends. If I have eaten, they have eaten. If they haven't eaten, I haven't eaten because I never eat without them. You ate in private.
Well, they are all lying, oh mother.
How can they lie? They are balakaha. They are less than 5 years old. According to Shastra, their words are as truthful as the words of the Vedic wisdom. So they are not lying. No, they are all lying. Even your older brother is saying so, Balaram. Now what will you say, Krishna? If you say he is lying, then you are breaking dharma. And if you say he is not lying, which means you are lying. So Krishna speaks his heart out. He says, oh mother, I don't know how this person became my brother. I really have to speak my heart out to you. There is a lot of pain in my heart. Acha, what is your pain? You know, you sent Balaram to protect me like an eyelid would protect an eyeball. But I have to tell you very honestly, I need an eyelid to protect me from this eyelid. He is the major cause of concern. No one else. Everyone else takes my side. It's him who's the cause of all causes. So Mother Yashoda's attention has got diverted now. From the mud in the mouth to Balaram Charitra. And at that time the acharyas described Krishna as busy pushing the mud in his mouth with his tongue and trying to clean between his teeth. He's very smart. Super smart. He says, oh mother, I have to tell you something very, very disturbing. In 2.5 years of my life, I've suffered so much. Okay, what happened, Lala? What happened? What did Dauji do? You know, in public, he makes fun of me. Okay, what does he say? One day he came in front of me, and we were all there. He looked at me, and he said, Krishna, I want to ask you a question. I said, yes, oh older brother, oh Dauji, you can ask me any question. And Balaram said, Mother Yashoda is fair. Nanda Baba is fair. I am fair. How are you dark? So Krishna looks at Balaram. He says, I don't know, maybe by chance. Balaram says, no, Krishna, no. This world is not as straightforward as you think it is. Listen to me, I have seen this world much more than you have. I'm much more experienced. How can I tell you? Kis muh se batau? How can I explain to you what the reality is? Krishna said, now I got to know. Balaram Dauji, please tell me. Balaram said, you are actually not the son of Nanda and Yashoda. No one knows who your parents are. Now this is all true. Because he's eternal. Ajopi san avyayatma bhutanam ishwaropi san. Prakritim swam adhishthaya sambhavami atma mayaya. Ajopi. Krishna doesn't have birth, material birth. He appears. So Balaram is saying, no one knows who your parents are. No one knows where you were born. Actually, I have to tell you something which parents are hiding from you, O Krishna. Krishna said, what is it? Balaram said, you were actually rescued from the streets of Vrindavan. Your parents just left you there. And Nanda Maharaj's heart melted as the king of Vrindavan, that who is this deserted child? He took charge and he promised that he will never tell you the secret. But as an older brother, I can keep secrets from you. I must tell you. Krishna is now bursting into tears. He's trying to hold composure because he can't cry in front of his friends. And he comes running to his mother and he says, is it true? Mother says, no way, what are you saying? You're my child. No, this is what Balaram says all the time. Mother Yashoda said, what can I do? Krishna said, I have a solution. There's a permanent solution to this problem. Okay, what is it? Krishna said, just get me married. Get me married off to someone who's fair complexioned. Someone very beautiful. Mother Yashoda said, acha? Why? Krishna said, Then at least next time when Balaram says, I can tell him, so what if I am dark? I have a beautiful fair wife. You are fair, but you have no girl in your life. Look at me. Acha. Mother Yashoda said, oh, you've planned so much ahead in your life, huh? So have you also thought of choices? Krishna took a very humble position and he said, oh, Mother, in Vrindavan, it's not that the boy and girl get married, it's two families who get married. It's the father and the father-in-law, and the mother and the mother-in-law, it's the families who get married, and as a result, the boy and girl come together. So I was thinking about this, and I really, really know for sure that Nanda Maharaj and Vrishabhanu Maharaj are best among friends. And you, Mother Yashoda, and Kirtida Devi are best friends. Because of that, Srimati Radharani, their daughter, who's also Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi, I feel everything falls in place. It's just because of that. So why don't you ask Vrishabhanu Maharaj and Mother Kirtida Devi? Mother Yashoda bursts out laughing. And now Krishna's recalling all of this. And telling Mother, do you remember all this happened? And then as Mother Yashoda's mind is diverted with rasantara, with change of topic, then Krishna has cleansed his mouth and he says, Naham bhakshitamanam va sarve mithyabhisamshinaha yadi satyagirastarhi samaksham pashyame mukham Naham bhakshitamanam va. Aham bhakshitavan. No means no. No, 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 Mother, no, no, no. I have not eaten dirt. They're all speaking false. And now if you want to know who's speaking truth, look into my mouth, simple. You know, just like if you tell me overnight, Prabhuji, you got to keep the milk in the fridge or else it'll get spoiled. And I say, okay, I'll do it. Next morning you ask me, did you keep the milk in the fridge? I said, yes. Are you sure? Then I'll say, okay, you come, I'll show you the fridge. The milk is inside. So what will you say? No, I trust you. I believe you. So Krishna thought of this parampara. And he told Mother Yashoda, if you don't believe me, you look into my mouth. But unfortunately, this backfired for the Supreme Personality of God. When Mother Yashoda was told, you look into my mouth, she said, okay, open up. And then when Krishna opened his mouth, the whole universe was shown. Mother Yashoda saw the moving, the non-moving, the animate, the inanimate, the 24 elements of material creation, the 5 working senses, the 5 knowledge acquiring senses, the 5 prominent elements, mind, intelligence, false ego, karmic reactions, reincarnations, everything. But then all that it took for Mother Yashoda to forget this vision was one sweet smile on Krishna's face. Interestingly, outside Vrindavan, when Krishna shows the universal form to Arjuna, for example, the Virat Roop, Arjuna gets bewildered. And his love falls from friendship to servitude. But in Vrindavan, every day Krishna shows his appearance. But their love just goes sky high. It doesn't fall down. Mother Yashoda feels, oh, seems like my son is also God. It's not like my son is God, oh. Sahasra sirsha purusha sahasraksha sahasrapat sabhumi pushpato vipatyatishtam dashangulam. Not the purusha sukta. It's only embraces and kisses that Krishna gets from Mother Yashoda. This is where the opulence, the Aishwarya gets eclipsed by the Madhurya, the sweetness. When Krishna would play in the dust, Mother Yashoda would dress Krishna up so beautifully, give him a nice bath, and comb his hair, tie his hair. Chandan, aguru, camphor, musk, all this fragrance and nice flowers and nice earrings and nice dhoti, nice matching waist cloth. And at the end, she would take, so that there's no evil eye. But what to do? She would get confused where she put it because it wasn't seen on Krishna's face. She would keep blessing Krishna with her love. This Krishna, who's so beautiful and so decked up, would go out and roll in the wet mud of Vrindavan. When he would come home, he's filled with mud. Filled, head to toe. And just the eyes are blinking. Mother Yashoda would say, "What is this?" And Krishna would show his teeth. Say, "It's me." Mother Yashoda would look at Krishna. Pankhabhishikta sakala vayavam vilokya damodaram vadati kopavashad Yashoda tvam sukarosi gata janmani putanare ityukta sasmita mukho vatuno murari. Hey Govinda, hey putanare, oh killer of putana, were you a pig in your last life? Krishna looks to himself and says, "Yes, Varahadev. My mother has recognized me." So he would just smile. Then in pure ecstatic love, there is knowledge and renunciation automatically. So she knows that I was a transcendental bore in my past life. So much of opulence, but completely eclipsed by sweetness. Krishna on the chariot to Arjuna showed the Virat Roop, Arjuna got bewildered, then also showed the four-handed form of Narayana, Arjuna got bewildered, then the two-handed form which Arjuna could relate to. So Krishna has displayed the form of Narayana in Vrindavan too. When he was performing the Rasa Leela, Vasanta Rasa Leela at Chandra Sarovar, even now that village is there, Petagaon. If you've gone Parikrama, you can see. So when Krishna disappeared from the Rasa Leela at Chandra Sarovar, very beautiful place. Has anyone been to Chandra Sarovar? So beautiful, so calm, so serene. Not any time, even during Kartik, you go to Chandra Sarovar, it's always going to be isolated. It's not one of those sought after places. If you go to Radhakund, you go to Govardhan Parikrama, you'll always find people. But if you really want to chant your 16 rounds, like in complete serenity, Chandra Sarovar is a place. The banks of Chandra Sarovar, so beautiful. No cars, no one around. It's just the waters of Chandra Sarovar and the Sadaka. So when Krishna left the Rasa Leela at Chandra Sarovar, the gopis went searching for him. And then Krishna assumed a four-handed Mahavishnu form. And the gopis came and looked at Mahavishnu, bowed down and said, "Can you tell us where our Shyamasundara is?" And with the four hands, he pointed in four directions. So the gopis split and they started running. Because it's a right answer. Where is your Shyamasundara? He's present everywhere. Anovaniyan Mahato Mahiyan. He's smaller than the smallest, larger than the largest. He's found in the atoms. He's balancing the cosmos. He's present everywhere. And the pure devotees also see Krishna everywhere. Yomam pashyati sarvatra sarvatra mai pashyati. So Krishna's there everywhere. So he pointed in four directions. Then Radharani came running and looked at Mahavishnu and said, "Can you tell me where my Shyamasundara is?" And Krishna could no longer hold his form and two of his hands melted and the flute appeared and he was playing, "Here I am." With ecstatic prema, Krishna appears. So all of these pastimes in Vrindavan and all this mention that this exit that we took in our discussion is only to understand the mood of Vrindavan to be different from the mood of Vaikuntha. It is the same Lord who is displaying more intimacy in Vrindavan. So all this discussion took place with Venkatabhat, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And Venkatabhat, Prabodhananda Saraswati, Tirumalabhat, Gopalabhat, they all surrendered to the Gaudiya Vaishnava philosophy. From that time, they all started following the teachings of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and worshipping Radha and Krishna. In fact, Prabodhananda Saraswati's works are saturated with Radha Krishna prema. You know, generally you have an author, he goes by a certain theme or flow, but Prabodhananda Saraswati is an intoxicated madman, transcendentally. Every verse was bursting in its own direction. Like, verse number 31 will describe something and 32 won't be in connection with 31, it'll be something else. So depending on the ecstatic eruptions in his heart, he composes. So in this way it is described so wonderfully that at the end of the two more weeks the Chaitanya Mahaprabhu stayed, there was ecstatic kirtan, katha, prasadam, charanamrita and seva. And at the end Chaitanya Mahaprabhu left. He blessed Gopal Bhatta Goswami and instructed him. Just like he instructed the other Goswamis. He said, "You should stay here with your parents." Gopal Bhatta Goswami said, "I want to come with you. I want to serve you personally. Please take me." Prema dhana vina vyartha daridra jivan. Without prema,
one is impoverished.
So please take me and empower me with pure love. He said, when the time comes, I will work through you. But for now, you serve your parents. They are pure Vaishnavas. By serving them, you make advancement. So Gopal Bhatta goes under Prabodhananda Saraswati. He served his parents for many years. And then once his parents were towards their last stages, they held the hand of Gopal Bhatta Goswami. And they said, our only desire is that after we depart from this world, you should go and serve Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Give your life for Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And in this mood, Venkata Bhatta and his good wife, both of them chanting the holy names of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, remembering the form of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, all the pastimes in their heart that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu spent time in their house. Remembering all of this, they left their bodies at the same time, both husband and wife. Gopal Bhatta Goswami received this last instruction to serve Chaitanya Mahaprabhu from his parents. Now instead of running to Jagannath Puri where Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was, he preferred to run to Vrindavan to fulfill the instruction of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So this is where Vapu Seva and Vani Seva come into picture for a devotee. Both are important. Vapu Seva means serving the manifest form of the Vaishnava or the pure spiritual master. And I think I'll need a glass of water if possible. My throat is just getting partial. And Vani Seva means fulfilling the instructions of the spiritual master. Srila Prabhupada would say both are important, but between the two, Vani Seva is more important. Because the form of the spiritual master may disappear after a point, but his instructions eternally reside. Vilasatu Ridhi Nityam Bhakti Siddhanta Vani. That may the teachings of Srila Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur eternally dance in the courtyard of my heart. Prabhupada would repeat this. Vilasatu Ridhi Nityam Bhakti Siddhanta Vani. Sometimes his godbrothers, Srila Prabhupada's godbrothers, would criticize Srila Prabhupada. That Srila Prabhupada didn't go to the Samadhi of Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur and so on and so forth. They would find some petty reasons to complain. Srila Prabhupada would smile and say, they have to go to meet their guru. But because I am executing the instruction of my guru travels with me. I don't have to go to the Samadhi. He's there with me. They believe he's gone, therefore they must go to the Samadhi. I don't believe he's gone. He's still present with me, so I don't have to go to the Samadhi. So the spiritual master resides with the disciple, lives with the disciple through his instructions. And Prabhupada would time and again say this. I eternally live in my books. Sometimes in room conversations, disciples would ask Srila Prabhupada, what would happen after you disappear? Prabhupada would say, I would never disappear. They would say, no, but Prabhupada, what would happen once you're no more? Prabhupada would say, I would always be there. But what if we cannot see you, Prabhupada? Prabhupada would say, you can find me in the pages of my books. Whatever I had to say is all there in these books. If you read these books, I am talking to you. So Vani Seva is very important. By reading the books of Srila Rupa Goswami, we are actually resonating and we are associating with the words of Rupa Goswami. Reading the works of Srila Prabhupada and Saraswati Thakur and thank you, Guruji, and Srila Bhaktivinoda Thakur, we are actually serving the Acharya. So Srila Gopal Bhatta Goswami, instead of running to Jagannath Puri and be with Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he decided to do Vani Seva. He went towards Vrindavan. And Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had told Rupa Goswami and Sanatana Goswami that one very wonderful boy called Gopal Bhatta is going to come to Vrindavan. And I have asked him, instructed him to assist you. So please take care of him like you would take care of your younger brother. Gopal Bhatta Goswami went to Vrindavan. And it was Rupa Goswami, Sanatana Goswami, Bhugarbha Goswami, Lokanath Goswami, who welcomed Gopal Bhatta Goswami. They offered garlands to Gopal Bhatta Goswami and they said, we have heard so much about your scholarship. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu told us so many beautiful things about your qualities. And we are very honored that you are here. You should kindly be here and let us serve you. Gopal Bhatta Goswami said, no, you are Gurujan. I have come here to assist you. And this way, very beautiful conversations took place. Parallelly in Jagannath Puri, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was reading Srimad Bhagavatam with Gadadhar Pandit and so many other associates. And both of them would embrace each other and cry. How can we understand? How can we understand that they wouldn't read Srimad Bhagavatam? They would weep while reading Srimad Bhagavatam. They would drink Srimad Bhagavatam. Just like you were describing Raghunath Bhatta Goswami, this is how they read Srimad Bhagavatam. They were not reading it. Yes, I know this, I know this. It's about experiencing what is happening there. The verses of Srimad Bhagavatam come alive by serving Vaishnavas. Otherwise, it will remain theoretical. Only when the senses are... Yes, Prabhuji? Vasudeva Katharuchi Syan Mahatsevaya Vipra Punya Tirthanishaiva. That the taste for hearing and understanding the Shastra comes by Mahatseva, by serving pure Vaishnavas. So this is the highest ideal in our life, to serve those who are better, higher ranked Vaishnavas. To serve all Vaishnavas, but we must try to be at the lotus feet of high class Vaishnavas. Rupa Goswami says this in Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu. Sajatiya ashaye snigdhe sadhu sanga swato vare. He says there are three things important. Sajatiya, that person must be like-minded. If you want to go to Vrindavan and you want to follow the footsteps of Subal Sakha, for example, and if that person is a worshipper of Lakshmi Narasimha, it's not like-minded. Sajatiya, having the same mood. Snikde, they must have genuine, loving concern and affection for you as a superior. And they must be sadhu. Swato vare, vara means higher and swato means self. Rupa Goswami says, the more we associate with people higher than us in spiritual standing, humility will develop because we will be humiliated in a good way. Because when we are with equals, it's always an egoistic clash in Kali. And when we are with juniors, oh, it's a very wonderful fake devotional attire to pull off, to impress. And if you're always with those who are junior in spiritual life, comparatively subordinate, then the false ego will just be puffed up all the time. But the more we are associating with senior Vaishnavas and we serve them humbly, there's no question of duplicity. They'll cut through us. So Gopal Bhatta Goswami said, no, you're superior. I just want to be at your lotus feet. And here in Jagannath Puri, as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and Gadadhar Pandit were reading Srimad Bhagavatam, both in Radha Bhav. Srimad Bhagavatam is actually the taste of Radharani's love for Krishna. It is spoken by Shukadev Goswami, who is Radharani's parrot. This whole Srimad Bhagavatam is Radharani's Bhav, and therefore Radharani's mention is not there because she's so selfless that she doesn't mention herself. She doesn't think of herself in her heart. So Srimad Bhagavatam is actually a portion of Radharani's love for Krishna. There are many reasons Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur gives as to why Radharani's name is not found in the Srimad Bhagavatam. In one Radhashtami class in 1932, Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur was asked this question as to why the name of Radharani is kept hidden in Srimad Bhagavatam. Radharani's name is invaluable, is a treasure. Why not just give it out to everyone? So Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur said, is it wise to protect a pearl necklace from monkeys by protecting it? Or is it wise to see the monkeys and wantonly giving it out? You know, the monkeys would just take the pearl necklace and break it apart and chew those pearls and throw it on the ground. So if anything is freely given, the monkey-like mentality will not have any regard for it. But the more confidential it is kept, the more the eagerness to find it. So this is why he's kept confidential. So anyway, there are many reasons like this. So both Chaitanya Mahaprabhu Krishna in Radha Bhav and Gadadhar Pandit Radharani in Radha Bhav are both ecstatically reading Srimad Bhagavatam and crying, and the pages are all wet. And at that time, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu tells Gadadhar Pandit, it's been such a long time I've heard from Rupa and Sanatan in Vrindavan. I don't know what is happening in Vrindavan. I wish Gopal Bhatta Goswami has reached safely. I have not received any message. And as Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was thinking and speaking this, one messenger comes. And it was very rare to receive messages like that. And he comes with a message and he says, here I have a message from Rupa and Sanatan in Vrindavan. And Mahaprabhu, it's for you. And Mahaprabhu opens up the letter and he reads the whole letter. And he sees it talks about Gopal Bhatta Goswami's arrival in Vrindavan and his transcendental qualities, how Rupa and Sanatan welcomed him and how humble and how meek he was. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had so much ecstasy. And he spoke to all the devotees from head to toe the transcendental qualities of Gopal Bhatta Goswami. And being happy, in reciprocation to that message, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu sent his kopin, his inner cloth. Because it is described that when a kopin of a self-realized, celibate, exalted personality is accepted as prasad, the attack of Kamadev, lust, will diminish in the life of a devotee. So therefore, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu even rips apart the kopin strands of Nityananda Prabhu and tells the devotees, if you tie it on your head, take it as prasad, then lust will go away. He gives us kopin. He gives us outer shawl, his bahir vas. And at the same time, he gives us wooden seat to sit on. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had a wooden asana that he would sit on. He sent it as prasad for Gopal Bhatta Goswami. And in that letter, he said, I instruct Gopal Bhatta Goswami to start giving diksha. So it's kind of fascinating. Rupa Goswami and Sanatan Goswami were very humble to accept anyone. Lokanath Goswami had taken a vrat, he will not initiate anyone. But what to do? The humility of Narottam Das Thakur broke the vrat of Lokanath Goswami. And he had to give diksha to Narottam Das Thakur. But here was Chaitanya Mahaprabhu giving outright instruction to Gopal Bhatta Goswami. And it's very beautifully described that when Gopal Bhatta Goswami entered Vrindavan, Asiya Paiya Rupa Sanatana Sange Dui Raghunatha Sangha Premera Tarange. So it's described that Gopal Bhatta Goswami, when he came to Vrindavan, he was welcomed by Rupa and Sanatan. And he not just welcomed, he had the association of Rupa and Sanatan and the two Raghunaths. Now the academic scholars start moving. They say, wait a minute. Raghunath Das Goswami went to Vrindavan after the departure of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. So how is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu on the planet while Gopal Bhatta Goswami enters Vrindavan? You see what's happening? Is everyone awake? Samadhi? Gopal Bhatta Goswami Paliki! So the answer to this is, that is not a context of the entrance of Gopal Bhatta Goswami. It just mentions as one of the verses that Gopal Bhatta Goswami during Vrindavan, Asiya Paiya, Rupa Sanatana Sange, Dui Raghunatha Sangha, Premera Tara. That it was not necessarily during the welcome, but after Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had left and Raghunath Das Goswami came, then Gopal Bhatta Goswami and the association. There's a book called Anuraga Valli, which describes these beautiful biographies and the academic research perspective of all of that. And that very beautifully reconciles. So Gopal Bhatta Goswami was now in Vrindavan. Rupa and Sanatan said, you're Pujari for Ranganath Dev of Sri Rangam. So you should now become the head Pujari of Radha Govinda Dev of Rupa Goswami. Gopal Bhatta Goswami started worshipping Radha Govinda Dev. And he received all these gifts. And as he got the gifts, the kopin and the wooden seat of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he would bow down to the kopin and bow down to the wooden seat and bow down to the chadar and again bow down to the kopin and again bow down to the wooden seat. Why? Because the articles, the paraphernalia which have been used by pure Vaishnavas are as worshipable as the pure Vaishnava. Aradhananam sarvesham Vishnu aradhanam param tasmat parataram devi tadiyanam samarchanam. Lord Shiva tells Mother Parvati, of all the worship of Vishnu is highest. But greater than the worship of Vishnu is the worship of Vishnu's pure devotee. Tadiya. So similarly, if you have any article, any paraphernalia used by a pure Vaishnava, that must be worshipped as wonderfully as the pure Vaishnava. I want to tell you a very beautiful story in Srila Prabhupada's biographies. One dear disciple of Srila Prabhupada received Srila Prabhupada's ring. Srila Prabhupada had many rings, and one of those rings was received by one of his disciples. Now this disciple kept that ring in his house in a nice box, in a nice case, And years after Prabhupada departed from this world also, he would worship the ring of Srila Prabhupada on the altar. You know, even now when you go to the Srila Prabhupada, what is that called? No, the Prabhupada house in Vrindavan. Even now you see all the articles that Prabhupada had used. So wonderfully documented and placed. You know, Prabhupada's glasses and Prabhupada's ink pen and Prabhupada's lotus footwear. Even in our Juhu temple, you remember Prabhupada's quarters? So beautiful. So beautiful. Very wonderfully kept. So he had this ring of Srila Prabhupada, which was very dear to his heart. Unfortunately, in his house, there was an accidental fire. Mm. And they had kept a bag ready with all the important documents. They were very well planned beforehand. Just in case if something happens, just take that bag and escape. And interestingly, that came handy. So they took the bag and they escaped, the family. And after they came out and the house was burning, this disciple realized, I am out, but Srila Prabhupada's invaluable ring that he gave me in so much faith is there burning inside. Now my question in this assembly is, what would we do in such a scenario? What is that, Mataji? Enter in the fire and get the article? Shamkun Prabhu? Are you okay with this proposal?
Good, he set his house on fire tomorrow.
He said, good, she didn't say, enter and stay there. Well, before any sparks of fire fly, let me continue with the story. So there was fire and this devotee didn't realize about the article. So they were all safe and the fire rescuers came, and then this devotee got this thought, Prabhupada's dear ring is inside. How dare I come out? Just like Anand Rupa Mataji said, this disciple was so dedicated to Srila Prabhupada and so much faith that the article of Srila Prabhupada is as worshipable as Srila Prabhupada. He actually jumped in that fire and entered the house amidst the burning. So we can speak all the goody-goody stuff when the temperature is good. But when Krishna increases the temperature little, can't even do a Govardhan Parikrama. Yes? It's impossible. This Prabhuji entered. He got Prabhupada's ring from the case, came out with that ring, and then was rushed to the hospital with 80% burns. Oh. Oh. I won't take names. 80% burns, but the ring was saved. What would we call this? So you can imagine Gopal Bhatta Goswami seeing the kopin and the wooden seat and the bahirvastra of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu bowing down and worshipping. This is Gaura Hari, Shachinandan Gaura Hari. And because of his ecstasy that night, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came in the dream. Gopal Bhatta Goswami was in Vrindavan worshipping Radha Govinda Dev. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came in the dream and he said, I want you to worship a Shaligram Srila. All of you have been waiting and waiting and waiting for the story, and I've been keeping you waiting and waiting for the story. But now is our time to hear about Radha Ramanji. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu said, I want you to worship a Shaligram Srila. And at that time it was not as easy. You know, you find another Brahmana who has a Shaligram Srila, just get it. The instruction given by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu was, walk your way back to Kali Gandaki, Nepal, present-day Nepal, and get a Shaligram Srila. The first Srila that you encounter, that's the Srila that you have to worship. And it's described, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, after this inspiration, also empowered Gopal Bhatta Goswami how to find a Srila. So Gopal Bhatta Goswami walked all the way from Vrindavan, all the way walking, to find one Srila to fulfill the instruction of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Our spiritual masters give us so many instructions. We take it so cheaply. At least talking about this stuff. My Guru Maharaj once hammered me about 35 minutes in a room conversation. There were 30 devotees in the room. They all wanted to meet Guru Maharaj. Guru Maharaj called me and he started speaking casually, and then he got so heavy. He was pounding. I could never imagine that aspect of Srila Radha Govind Maharaj. And very heavy. Very, very heavy. Like, it was like a butcher's knife. And to add supreme salt to the wound, 30 devotees in the room hearing it. It's not just one to one. They're listening very attentively. Guru Mukha Padma Vakya, Chitta Te Gauri Aikya. It's very beautiful when you're an onlooker. I started off looking at Guru Maharaj's face, and then it was like, and then I was just looking at his lotus feet, and it was hammering, pounding. And then the personal servant came and told Srila Guru Maharaj, there are others also waiting, maybe we can give time. Guru Maharaj said, I'm not done speaking to him yet. It's not done, another 10-15 minutes. So about 20 instructions he gave me in that 35 minutes. But, you know, we don't take it as intensely as we should. But I have to tell you very honestly, that is the best day of my life. That 35 minutes that I had in my life. Those were the best moments. Guru Maharaj realized that I was being, like, beaten up, literally. You were there that day?
No, you were not there.
I think my mother was there, right?
Yeah.
This was another Rasbiri time. And we waited for 3-4 hours to get in for these 35 minutes. And then I was putting my head down, and Guru Maharaj was really chastising, very heavy. And then towards the end, he realized that it was getting too much for me to take. Then he told me a story to cut a joke to make me smile. And I have a picture where I'm looking at Guru Maharaj and smiling, laughing at that joke. The biggest treasure of my life. Seen that picture? So the point is, we hear all these instructions, but how many instructions do we take it too hard? Understanding that it is Krishna, Chaitya Guru, who's speaking as our Diksha Guru, our spirit. But for Gopal Bhatta Goswami, one dream and he set out. Finished. We would probably think, no, all day, you know, I was thinking about the Kopin and the wooden seat, and therefore naturally I saw Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. What do you think during the day, you dream during the night? Maybe it's just a superimposition of my thoughts. Nothing to worry. Anyway, Gandaki is too far away, so I don't think Mahaprabhu would want me to walk. Atmavat manyate jagat, as Prabhupada would say. We think the whole world thinks like us. But Gopal Bhatta Goswami took it as Mahaprabhu's calling and he started walking. And it's described Mahaprabhu would become Kurma Chaitanya in ecstasy. He would become like a tortoise. His hands would go inside and his middle portion of his body would be like a shell. And he would be like that in ecstasy. And sometimes his hands and legs would be dislocated, floating on the surface of the ocean like a haunted ghost. So this form of Kurma Chaitanya manifested as the first Shaligram Srila, the Chaitanya that Gopal Bhatta Goswami was going to take. So Gopal Bhatta Goswami entered the water, the sacred water. And he took water to offer it to the sun. And as he took holy water, he got a Shaligram Srila. So he put the Srila back, thinking, no, I haven't offered to Suryadev first. Then again he took his hand, and again a Shaligram Srila. Again he pushed it, again he took it, again a Shaligram Srila, and the same Srila again and again. So he realized, oh, this is the first Srila that Chaitanya Mahaprabhu wants me to accept. And then later he placed the Srila very carefully. And then again he took another Srila. Again he took water, another Srila. In this way he collected another 11 Srilas. So 12 Srilas that Gopal Bhatta Goswami got. And interestingly, the first Srila, which was Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's manifestation, was a Damodar Srila. So 12 Srilas in all, Shaligrams. So he got them to Vrindavan. And interestingly, during his way to Kali Gandaki, while he was going towards Kali Gandaki, he passed through a village called Devabandha. Through this village, while passing through Devabandha, he met a Brahmana by the name Madhav Prasad Sharma. And he had two sons by the name Gopinath Sharma and Damodar Sharma. And Gopal Bhatta Goswami initiated them. They were traveling with him. So they assisted Gopal Bhatta Goswami in the worship of the Srilas. Then as we know, in Vrindavan, all the leading Goswamis, they all have their own murtis.
Jiva Goswami had Radha Damodar there, which Rupa Goswami had personally carved out for him. And Rupa Goswami had Radha Govinda there, whom he found under the Gomatagiri, which we'll speak in a few days from now. Then Sanatan Goswami had his Madan Mohan deity, which was actually the original Madan Gopal deity of Advaita Acharya. So all these prominent deities were attracting the hearts and minds of Brijvasis. And one very wealthy rich man, a merchant actually, he was going around donating flutes and turbans and ornaments and waist cloths and ankle bells and bhoga and flower garlands and all of these for all these deities. And then he came and he gave for the worship of Gopal Bhatta Goswami Shaligrams also. He gave a crown, he gave a flute, he gave a waist cloth, he gave ankle bells, he gave necklaces, he gave bracelets. And Gopal Bhatta Goswami is thinking, none of this makes sense. None of this makes sense. Because my Shaligram Shila, who Sakshat Bhagavan Shri Krishna, is in the form of a Shila, a stone. He doesn't have hands and legs and eyes and ears to put earrings and bangles and waist belts and ankle belts. So this was a big anxiety. And that night when he went off to sleep, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu again appeared in the dream and told Gopal Bhatta Goswami, I am very pleased with your worship. And I am very pleased you initiated Gopinath Sharma and Damodar Sharma to assist you. And I also know that your heart is anxious that the Shaligram doesn't have a form. But I promise you, very soon, Sri Krishna in a threefold bending form will manifest from the Shila, depending on your intensity and hankering. And Gopal Bhatta Goswami felt so ecstatic getting to know that his Shaligram is now going to get a threefold bending form where he can keep a flute and earrings and ankle belts and waist belt. He can put a turban. He can put all the ornaments. The asana, vasana, bhushana, paduka, chatra, all of this. So what he would do? He would put his Shaligrams in a very sacred cloth and tie them to a branch of a tree and swing them during Jhulan Yatra. Because he didn't have Radha and Krishna, he just has Shilas. How much love? And he would weep. He would say, Krishna, till the time you don't manifest, you have to accept my service in the form of Shilas. He would swing them back and forth singing songs. And when he would see the Shila, he would imagine the face to be like Radha Madan Mohan of Sanatan Goswami. The chest to be like Radha Govinda Dev of Rupa Goswami. And the feet to be like Radha Gopinath. Different biographers give it differently. One biographer gives it as Govinda, Gopinath, Madan Mohan. Another biographer gives it as Madan Mohan, Govinda and Gopinath, depending on Sambandha, Abhideya and Prayojana. Well, the essence is, he imagined how his deity is going to look. He was trying to take different pieces of different deities and try to imagine the form of his future deity. But his intensity and hankering just went day after day after day after day, just went higher. It was exploding like a volcano. Everyone would worship. They would get flower garlands and they would get waist belts. He would go and different deities would have waist cloths and ankle belts, and he would come back and he would look at his Shilas and cry. He would say, today I have to bathe you with the water of my tears. Why don't you take a form? Why don't you take a form? I know you were there. Now the word Shaligram or Shalagram, according to Padma Puran, Shala means glories, glorification. And Grama means a village. So village of glorification. Now in village we know, every house is related to every house in friendship. It's not like you don't know your neighbor. Everyone knows everyone and they come with a stick in times of need. So village is considered to be a symbol, an emblem of unity. So Shalagram means that place, that personality, who is a Shila, a stone, who is worthy of village-like, united, collective glorification. So it's very glorious to worship Shaligram Shilas. Padma Puran describes different Shilas on the basis of the chakras and the chinhas. If they have an open vadana, and if they have a chakra on the top and a chakra on the bottom, and they meet, it's a certain Shila. If they don't meet, it's a certain Shila.
If they have three chakras, it's a certain Shila, and so on and so forth. So Gopal Bhatta Goswami worshipped every day, but his mood exploded on the day of Narasimha Chaturdashi. Why? Because everyone was speaking of the story for Prahlad Maharaj, the Lord came out of pillar, which is stone. So Gopal Bhatta Goswami would hear the story all day from everyone. He would walk different streets to get away from the story. And they would say, Gopal, do you know Narasimha Deva came from a pillar? And he can appear from a stone. Do you know this? And Gopal Bhatta Goswami's heart. Only if I was Prahlad. He told his Shaligram, he gave an ultimatum. Prem Pash. He has bound his Shilas with ropes of love. He gave an ultimatum to his Shilas. He said, I am going to the Yamuna to take my snan. I will give you time. By the time I come back, I should see something. If I don't see a manifestation of your form, then I will tie all these Shilas to my neck and jump into Yamuna and commit suicide. What is the use of worshipping you if you can't reciprocate with your devotee? Don't be so stone-hearted. So only pure devotees can chastise Krishna like this. We cannot. If we chastise, we already have mountains of aparad. And then Krishna will say, Acha, you already have seva aparad, nam aparad, dham aparad, jiva aparad, vaishnava aparad. And now this audacity. We cannot do it. This is expression of prem. This is a love quarrel. So he told his Shilas, now the Shilas were trembling. Gopal Bhatta Goswami went to take snan and he came back. And so beautiful did he see. With his own eyes, he couldn't believe, tears coming down his eyes. His Damodar Shila had manifested into a very, very beautiful threefold bending form of Sri Sri Radha Ramanji. So beautiful. Only so much. So small. So beautiful. He is the heartbeat of Vrindavan. Bhakti Siddhanta Saraswati Thakur would say, Radharaman is the only deity who didn't leave Vrindavan ever. All other deities were taken to Jaipur and Karoli in fear of all other attacks from the Mughal kings. But Radharaman is so small a deity, he can be put in the pocket and you can hide him. But you can't hide these big deities. So he never left Vrindavan. Anyone who takes the darshan of Radharaman gets the benefit of seeing Govindji, Gopinath and Madan Mohan and all the 5,000 temples in Vrindavan. They are Gopal Bhatta Goswami's Pranathana. Worshipped with so much love. And interestingly, the form was such that all the ankle bells and bracelets and the waist cloth exactly fit Radharaman. And here was Radharaman playing the flute with distinct fingers. And with feet, oh, so beautiful, with his eyes, and with his lips, and with his nose. How many of us have seen Radha Ramanji?
Jai Jai Radha Raman Hari Bo, Jai Jai Radha Raman Hari Bo, Jai Jai Radha Raman Hari Bo.
Gauraj se bhare hai kapo, jai jai radha raman hari bol.
Radharaman in Vrindavan has his own steam engine. He has his own ship. He has his own train. He has everything of his own. He has his own dining room. And the deity's taken there to have his lunch, to have his prasad. And sometimes he sits on a steam engine and he's taken around a room for his entertainment. They wake up Radharaman as a baby and they have a datun they use for brushing his teeth. So beautiful. The fire that is used to cook prasad for Radharaman has been burning for 500 years. The fire has never got extinguished. It's not that they set fire every time. It's the same fire. So beautiful. And interestingly, Radharaman, because he manifested from a Shaligram Shila, it's just one form. There is no Radharani there. There is no Radharani. Then why is he called Radharaman? Because Rupa Goswami Pad said, he has appeared near Nidhivan, or Niduvan, the place of the Rasalila. So this is the place where Krishna, he gives pleasure to Radharani. So therefore he must be called Radha Ramana. Because the word Rama or Ramana means to give pleasure. Ramante yogino nante satyananda chidatmani iti Rama padena sau para brahma vidhiyate. He's called Rama because innumerable pure devotees who are muktas, liberated, they take pleasure in him. And he gives pleasure to Radharani in Nidhivan. Therefore he's called Radharaman. And interestingly, when you see on the altar, you see a very beautiful throne with Radharani there, with a very nice decoration with cloth. So the Goswamis describe many reasons. They say this deity, Radharaman, is Krishna, and this cloth covering here inside has a feather with Radha written in Sanskrit in golden letters. So that Radha Nam is not different from Radharani, so it's Radharaman. Another meaning is they say that in the heart of Krishna is Radharani, so it's Radharaman. Like that. So very beautifully he was decorated, and all the Vaishnavas came and they bowed down to see the power potency of Gopal Bhatta Goswami's worship. Gopal Bhatta Goswami, he was afraid of what's going to happen to Radharamanji after he departs. So he told his disciples, please take care. He told Gopinath Sharma, whom he had initiated, he told them, please take care of Radharaman, which means you have to get married, because if you're celibate, after your time, it's going to be, again, who's going to take care of Radharaman? So you have to get married. Gopinath Sharma said, Gurudev, you give me any instruction, I will fulfill, but I don't want to get married. I want to be brahmachari. So then, the other brother, anyone remembers the name?
Damodar
Sharma, yes. So Gopal Bhatta Goswami told Damodar Sharma, you have to get married. He said, okay. So the present line that we see of Pundarik Goswami in Radharaman comes down that line of Damodar Sharma, the disciples of Gopal Bhatta Goswami. Gopal Bhatta Goswami lived in Vrindavan. He wrote many beautiful works. The Hari Bhakti Vilas, which is very popularly called as Sanatan Goswami's work, is actually Gopal Bhatta Goswami's work. Gopal Bhatta Goswami wrote this work, and Sanatan Goswami compiled it and organized it systematically. Similarly, another great work in the Gaudiya literature, the Shatsandarbhas, which is credited to Jiva Goswami, is actually the original work of Gopal Bhatta Goswami. Jiva Goswami in the Shatsandarbhas, in the Mangala Charana, he says, this is actually the work of a very great scholar from South India. He calls him Dakshinatya Brahmana. And Baldev Vidya Bhushan, when he comments, he says that is Gopal Bhatta Goswami. So Jiva Goswami has compiled and put things together in proper order. Gopal Bhatta Goswami is the one who has given the content. Even the Satkriya Saradipika, which is the essence of all the samskaras and the arati, deity worship, even the, you know, the deity worship manual comes profusely from the Satkriya Saradipika, which is the work of Gopal Bhatta Goswami. So Gopal Bhatta Goswami was a very great scholar. But now there was a big anxiety in the life of the Acharyas, the six Goswamis. They are writing all these works, but what's going to happen after their time? So for this work, Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu empowered three wonderful Acharyas. He empowered Srinivas Acharya, who who's a partial incarnation of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. He empowered Narottam Das Thakur, who's a partial incarnation of Nityananda Prabhu. And Shyamananda Prabhu, who's a partial expansion and incarnation of Advaita Acharya. So these three great personalities were empowered for preserving the books of the six Goswamis. So today we have Bhakti Rasamrita Sindhu and Upadeshamrita and all of these wonderful books by their protection policy. Not just protection, they actually even distributed it far and wide. Now if I can elaborate a little with your permission, I want to take your permission to dwell a little bit into the life of Srinivas Acharya. Srila Srinivas Acharya was the son of Chaitanya Das, who all day and night only spoke about Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. The activities of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the form of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the names of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the pastimes of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the dham of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the associates of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, the devotees of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, and the glories of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's gift of loudly chanting Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram. Chaitanya Das would keep speaking this so much so that Srinivas Acharya now had a burning desire. I want to find Chaitanya Mahaprabhu in my life. And interestingly, that night Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came in the dream of Srinivas Acharya and said, you must come to Neelachala Dham, Puri Dham and meet me. Because very soon I'm going to wrap up my pastimes. I want you to come ASAP. So immediately Srinivas Acharya left. He left home. He left Navadvip now to go to Jagannath Puri. He walked all the way to Jagannath Puri. And as he entered Jagannath Puri, he saw everyone crying and weeping. He asked what happened. The devotees came and told him Chaitanya Mahaprabhu just disappeared. Imagine the personality whom you love the most in your life comes in the dream and tells you to come and meet him. And you reach there and just get to know he just passed away, just left, just disappeared. There's one devotee I know who used to live in Delhi, and he was so attached to Sripad Ayendra Prabhu. Sripad Ayendra Prabhu would tell him, why are you living in this helly, smelly Delhi? You should live in Vrindavan, leave everything and come to Vrindavan, leave everything and come to Vrindavan. So he said, okay, I will leave everything and come to Vrindavan, but not now. But finally, when he agreed to leave everything and come to Vrindavan, he came on the 17th of July 2010. He reached Vrindavan and he realized Ayendra Prabhu had left one day ago. Can you imagine? The person whom he loved the most, who was beseeching him to come to Vrindavan, and he finally came only to realize he could never see him again. Srinivas Acharya went to Jagannath Puri and he got to know Chaitanya Mahaprabhu had just disappeared. He was rolling on the ground crying out, Gauranga, Gauranga. Mahaprabhu appeared to him and said, don't worry, go to Tota Gopinath and study Srimad Bhagavatam under Gadadhar Pandit. He's still on the planet. So now he went to Tota Gopinath and Gadadhar Pandit was there. He didn't leave. He was there. He went there and he told Gadadhar Pandit, Mahaprabhu has instructed me to learn Srimad Bhagavatam from you. Gadadhar Pandit said, yes, I am ready to teach you. Mahaprabhu told me to teach you. I am ready. That's the only reason why I am alive. I feel like living with Mahaprabhu. But I've kept my body and soul together only to teach you Srimad Bhagavatam. But there's one problem. The only copy of Srimad Bhagavatam that I had, because of our tears, it's got smudged. I can't see anything. You get another copy of Srimad Bhagavatam and I'll teach you. So now he couldn't go to, you know, the local ISKCON center and get a set. He went all the way back to Navadvip and no one had a copy. And it was not that easy. It was very, very difficult. He found a brahmana who could extract, dyes from different herbs and then from the barks of the trees make paper. And with that dye and on that paper from that bark of the tree, now make a very organic instrument to use it to write. And then write 18,000 verses, not copied, handwritten. And he finished the copy, he had Srimad Bhagavatam, he went back to Tota Gopinath and devotees were crying that Gadadhar Pandit had left his body. He was weeping and rolling, he said, why this is happening to me? They promised Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, he left this world. Then he promised Gadadhar Pandit and he has left this world. Now where will I go? Gadadhar Pandit appeared to him in his meditation and said, don't worry. Go to Vrindavan, Rupa and Sanatana are there for you. They will teach you, don't worry. So he walked. He walked to Vrindavan. He walked to Vrindavan. He came to Mathura, took his bath at Vishram Ghat, and devotees are weeping. He said, what happened? He said, Rupa and Sanatana just left this world. Now he felt, let me just jump into Vishram Ghat and commit suicide. I don't have to live. I'm utterly unqualified. I cannot get Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, I cannot get Gadadhar Pandit, I cannot get Rupa and Sanatan. Why should I live in this world? Rupa and Sanatan appeared to him in his meditation and said, don't worry. There is one very exalted and very merciful Acharya still present in Vrindavan. And his name is Gopal Bhatta Goswami. We want you to take shelter of him, take Diksha from him. But learn Srimad Bhagavatam from Srila Jiva Goswami. Went there. And at the same time, now he doesn't know where to find Gopal Bhatta Goswami. Because it's not like you can call and say, you know, is your ashram open? Can I come? It's no website. There's no contact. You don't know where these acharyas are sitting. They're sitting in some cave and no one knows. Where will you go? Whom will you ask? Kaha jao, kaha pao, Brajendra Nandan. Where will I find Krishna? That's how they would look for acharyas. But interestingly, for Jiva Goswami, in his meditation, Rupa and Sanatan appeared and said, I have ordered Srinivas Acharya to learn under you. And in the meditation for Gopal Bhatta Goswami, Rupa and Sanatan came and said, we have ordered Srinivas to come and you have to give him Diksha. So now Gopal Bhatta Goswami, Srinivas Acharya didn't know where to go, so he went to Radha Govinda Dev temple. And he was sitting there and crying, thinking, sometime Gopal Bhatta Goswami will come to take darshan. He must come to take darshan of Radha Govinda Dev. And when he comes, I will surrender to him. But then Jiva Goswami came there to take darshan. And he looked at him and he said, Srinivas Acharya, Rupa Goswami instructed me to teach you Srimad Bhagavatam. He said, yes, and I was instructed to take shelter of your divine grace. He said, I don't know where Gopal Bhatta Goswami is. Jiva Goswami said, don't worry, I will take you to him. He first took him to Radha Damodar temple. Blessings from his deities which were carved personally by Rupa Goswami. And after bowing down to Radha Damodar and taking prasadam of Radha Damodar, he took him to Seva Kunj, which is in the same area as Radha Damodar. And then after that, he took him to Nidhiman, which is another Rasasthali. And from there, he took him to Radha Raman. And there was Gopal Bhatta Goswami weeping and rolling in ecstatic love, worshipping Radha Raman. He said, this is Gopal Bhatta Goswami. Srinivas Acharya prostrated himself like a stick and told him, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu promised me to come to Jagannath Puri and give me shelter. I went, he disappeared. Then I went to Chota Gopinath, Gadadhar Pandit disappeared. Then I went to Vrindavan, Rupa and Sanatan disappeared. You are my only shelter. Please don't leave this world. And he bowed down and Gopal Bhatta Goswami very mercifully placed his lotus feet on the head of Srinivas Acharya. Now Srinivas Acharya is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's incarnation. Just like Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, when he was taking Diksha from Keshava Bharati Maharaj and at the same time from Sannyas Diksha and when he was taking Harinam from Ishwara Puripad, both of them told Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, how can we initiate you? And Mahaprabhu spoke the Sannyas mantra in the ear of Keshav Bharati Maharaj and said, you please tell me this mantra. And then he said, oh yes, I got initiated from you. But it was actually Chaitanya Mahaprabhu who initiated and got the echo effect. So similarly here, it is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu taking shelter of Gopal Bhatta Goswami by actually guiding him as Srinivas. So Srinivas Acharya takes shelter of Gopal Bhatta Goswami, who is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Srinivas Acharya is Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. And they find him by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's instruction. So it goes like a circle. After prostrating himself at the lotus feet of Gopal Bhatta Goswami, he finds his associates Narottam Das Thakur, Ramchandra Kaviraj, Shyamananda Prabhu. Shyamananda Prabhu is a disciple of Hriday Chaitanya Prabhu. Narottam Das Thakur is a disciple of Lokanath Goswami. Ramchandra Kaviraj is a disciple of Srinivas Acharya. So it's so fascinating. Srinivas Acharya is a disciple of Gopal Bhatta Goswami. Narottam Das Thakur is a disciple of Lokanath Goswami. And Shyamananda Prabhu is a disciple of Hriday Chaitanya, which means three different Diksha Gurus. But they came together at the lotus feet of their Siksha Guru, that is Jiva Goswami. It also teaches us a very practical lesson. We may have devotees in our community who are from different disciples of different spiritual masters. But we come together keeping our Siksha Guru, Srila Prabhupada, in the center. They never fought, I am Gopal Bhatta Goswami's disciple and you are Lokanath Goswami's disciple and you are Hriday Chaitanya's disciple. There's no Guru groupism there. Because those who understand Guru Tattva understand it is Akhanda Guru Tattva. It is undivided. It's one. Somebody may appear to be this personality, the Guru may manifest as another personality, but it's actually just one. So they served under Jiva Goswami, and Jiva Goswami taught Shyamananda Prabhu, Narottam Das Thakur and Srinivas Acharya. And by learning all this, they took these books of the Goswamis. And then the story continues in the Bhakti Ratnakara and other scriptures, how it was stolen. And they recovered and made multiple handwritten copies. And today we have the English translation of all these books because they were preserved. They were preserved in the first place. Imagine the six Goswamis sent by Chaitanya Mahaprabhu writing all these books and then we lose those books then. We lose the treasure of Gaudiya Siddhanta. Gopal Bhatta Goswami lived like this in Vrindavan all his life. And in 1586, on the 100th appearance anniversary of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu, chanting the holy name, he left his body in front of Radharamanji in Vrindavan. So Bhakti Ratnakar gives a very beautiful pranam mantra for Gopal Bhatta Goswami. Let us kindly chant that as we wrap up this class. Vande Shri Bhatta Gopalam,
Vande Shri Bhatta Gopalam,
Dvijendram Venkatatmajam,
Dvijendram Venkatatmajam,
Shri Chaitanya Prabhum Seva,
Shri Chaitanya Prabhum Seva,
Niyuktam Cha Nijalaye,
Niyuktam Cha Nijalaye,
Vande Shri Bhatta Gopalam. I bow down to that Gopal Bhatta Goswami who is Dvijendra. He is the best among Brahmanas and Venkata Atmajam. The dear child of Venkata Bhatta Goswami. And Sri Chaitanya Prabhum Seva Niyuktam. And he engaged himself completely in the service of Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. Where? Nija Alaye, in his own house. In this way Gopal Bhatta Goswami lived his life so beautifully. And most biographers tried to keep his life hidden. But all glories, all glories, all glories to Narottam Das Thakur, Prem Vilas, and Bhakti Ratnakar of Narahari Chakravarti, which have opened up whatever we know little about Gopal Bhatta Goswami. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu instructed, six Goswamis wrote, Shyamananda, Srinivas, and Narottam preserved and distributed. But it still came down in Bengali and Sanskrit. And Srila Prabhupada, after 1965, for the first time in the history of Gaudiya Siddhanta, translated it in a language which the whole world can understand. Can we see what current Srila Prabhupada is carrying on his shoulders? So today when we do the Guru Puja, this is the meditation. I don't know Gopal Bhatta Goswami, but Prabhupada, it is you who opened me to Vrindavan Dham. It is you who opened me to Radharaman. It is you who opened me to Satkriya Saradipika and Hari Bhakti Vilas and Shat Sandarbhas. Prabhupada, it is because of you that I have the six Goswamis on my altar. I would have not known them. I would have spent my whole human form not knowing even Sri Chaitanya Mahaprabhu. It is because of your choking voice that you sing with so much ecstasy the six Goswami Ashtakam that we can read the translation and appreciate these six personalities in our life. So saying this, I offer my prostrated obeisances to all the Vaishnavas and Vaishnavis present here. If I said something wrong, please kindly forgive me and kindly reconcile in your heart. I'm a conditioned soul, so to make mistakes and to err is human, but to forgive is divine. So saying this, we wrap up the class and this wraps up day 3 of our 6-day seminar. We have 3 more days to go. And the three personalities under discussion
Shri Jiva Goswami, Sanatana Goswami, and Rupa Goswami. Now, what order it's going to take? Shankar Goswami Pad ki
Jai.
Srila Gopal Bhatta Goswami Pad ki
Jai.
Om Shanti Shanti Shanti.